It's just really wonderful and fantastic to be here in front of all of you. I think thanks to IIA for giving this opportunity to interact with all of you here and for several other people live. I think it's quite symbolic of the topic, quite interesting. I was thinking as I was coming for this session is that here we are talking about digital and connecting to each other in a digital way. There's no better way from the usual seminar format where everybody has to take out time, travel to a location. This has been done at everybody's convenience. So it's quite sort of symbolic of our topic today. I think, like Manish mentioned, that what I thought this is part of the series of webinars. So I'll focus my initially the way I think thought that we'll do the next approximately an hour that we're going to spend. I'll spend the next 20 minutes, 20, 25 minutes maximum on just giving you a perspective about what I believe, especially focus on, what is my area from a sales and marketing perspective, what I think is the implication of the digital environment on marketing today, and more specifically, I think what I believe is that how the digital world is going to transform the way we market to our customers. So let me start by saying that the first thing is that, like all things in marketing, you've got to start looking at it from a consumer point of view. And I think the first thing that we got to chat about is that how relevant is the digital environment for the consumers today? And what I'll do is I'm going to share some stats with you, some stats which will give it a perspective about how consumers are spending time online, and more importantly, how we're entering into a world, what I call a phase, where consumers are going to be the connected consumers. So let's spend some time on what does this connected consumer mean. The first thing is that, I think everybody knows that increasingly consumers are getting connected across the board. And I came across this interesting study by a US consulting company, which said that approximately there are 30 countries in the world which will have 100% per capita connectivity by the turn of this decade. And that's quite startling. What we're really saying is that by 2020, there will be 30 countries in the world which will have almost everybody in that country being connected online. And things are not very different today. So as we speak in this, as the year will end, around 80% of people in those countries will have internet connectivity, which means, and this includes large countries like the US. Now, what that means on a world at large is that there are around 40% of people in the world who are connected online. And that's a staggering number. Now, if you look at India, yeah, we have home distance to travel. We have done about 12% of the market is now on internet. But this is surely changing at a very fast pace. So really what we're talking about is that we're talking about a world that we're entering into where we're going to have the haves and the have-nots. And there are going to be people who are connected online, and there are people who are not going to be connected online. If you look at these countries, we're really talking about a situation where if these countries were to determine what's going to be the poverty line in these countries, we'll probably be talking about a situation where apart from having some basic facilities, they also need to be connected. Now, not only are people getting connected, they are also spending a lot of time. So if you look at the West and the US, around 37 hours are spent by a connected consumer every month. That's a large number. And to put that in perspective, we're talking about be spending about an hour, hour and a half every day. And if I were to put that as a comparison to television, where they spend approximately 2.5 to 3 hours, that'll give you a sense that television, which has been around for 5 decades, just as an advertising medium, versus internet. What internet has taken to reach 50% in a decade is what television took 5 decades. That's the power of the medium. India is a bit behind. Obviously, it's got distance to travel. This is about 3 hours a week, but that's changing also at a very rapid pace. Now, let's look to the third dimension of this, which is transaction. Not only people are connected, they're spending time, they also prefer to transact online. And I think the booming e-commerce market is a great example of how people are are moving their transaction preferences online. Citi itself is a fabulous example in the banking world, where around 55% of our transactions on a monthly basis happen online. Now, this is not only an illustration of Citi being a premier digital bank, but also a manifestation of the fact that consumers are increasingly putting their preferences to transact online. Now, why is that happening? That's happening because that more and more people are getting connected to smart devices. Now, I think everybody knows that, has heard about the smartphones. I'm not going to talk too much about that, but I will bring about this important fact that last year was an interesting year where, for the first time globally, the world bought or world sold more smartphones than they sold feature phones. And that's a very important landmark from a mobile smartphone industry point of view. That means that in the future, we're going to have more smartphones than we ever had before. But you know, that's not the most interesting thing. For me, the most interesting change which is happening that marketers need to note is that this smart is becoming the new normal, not only when it comes to mobile phones, but also in almost every facet of our everyday life. So whether you're talking about a watch, you're talking about a car, you're talking about an apparel, even things like diapers are becoming smart. Now you may be thinking that I'm actually pushing to make a point that how can you have a smart diaper, but the interesting thing is that a couple of 2-3 months back, a company in New York launched a diaper which had a patch in the front, which you know has an ability where if a kid was to pass any fecal matter, that patch in the front will change its color. And if you are a parent moving with a child and you're concerned about the children's health, you can take a photograph of this patch, sync it up online, and you will get an instant report whether everything is fine with the kid compared with the digestive system. So that's quite remarkable. Could you have ever imagined to have smart diapers and the company is charging a 30% premium there? Now, these smart devices, these numbers are not small. You know, when you look at things like, even things like smart cars, so in the U.S. in last year, 17% of the cars sold in the U.S. were smart cars. Cars where the console units had an ability to connect back to internet, and you could sync up that console with the online music library and play music in your car. And that's a staggering number. And when you look at the world stat, you know, leading consulting companies have put out a number out there that by the turn of this decade, again in the next 6 years, the number of smart devices, which is, you know, including our mobile phones, that will be utilized across the world will be 5 to 6 times the world's population. Now, to me, that is an astounding change coming our way, which we, you know, from a marketing perspective, you've got to take note of. Because what it tells you that these smart devices, which are getting connected every day, will just multiply the data and the information being consumed by consumers. And a lot of information that marketers like us are pushing out today is going to get consumed in that fashion. You know, the average consumption now of, in terms of just data, the average consumption of on internet has already reached about a couple of gigabytes per user across the world per month. That's a very large number. Now let's look at the third dimension of the connected consumer, right? So we spoke about connectivity, we spoke about smart devices. The third dimension is social connectivity. And if you look at social connectivity, again, a lot has been spoken about that, but I'll just, you know, put one headline thought on that. To me, that's a big area itself because people are getting connected to smart devices and getting connected socially. 1 in 4 minutes spent on internet in India or anywhere in the world is on social platforms. Now, it is not a small number we're talking about. We're saying that 25% of data consumption is happening through social networks. And this number is only increasing every month. That's because, you know, there are companies like Facebook, which we already know, but there are new companies getting launched every month where, you know, in the US, some of them are making it really big. And there is every year, every few months, you hear about a Tumblr, you hear about a Pinterest, you hear about an Instagram, which is growing. Now, there was a company which got started about last year in the US called Snapchat, where you can send snaps on social networks along with some text written on it. It just started, you know, last year, and you know, I don't know whether you would know that by the end of this year, which is in a month from now, on a monthly basis, 300 million photographs are being exchanged on that social network today. So that's the power of how this medium is evolving and how it's changing the way people are behaving. So that's the first part of what I wanted to say about the connected consumer. So let's shift the gear and say, what does that mean for marketers, right? So obviously, the first thing, again, if consumers are spending time there, the thing that is normally spoken about from a digital marketing perspective is digital advertising. But I don't want to spend too much time, but I'll touch upon it very briefly. So from a digital advertising perspective, you know, it's a 3,000 crore market growing at around 30%. It's around 8% of the total advertising expenditure in the industry. And it's growing fast, but it's still small. It's growing fast. It was about 1% of the market in 2005, and is now 7-8%. But it's still underutilized because if you were to look at the 36 hours in the US or, you know, even 12 hours in India and compare that with the amount of time being spent on traditional mediums by people like us, it is still neck to neck, but the expenditure is about 1/4 or 1/3 of some of the leading traditional medium. So that means that the opportunity of this medium is underexploited, under understood, and not leveraged the way it should have been. What I want to talk to you people today about was not really about digital advertising. What I really want to talk about is the fact that the fundamental opportunity of digital goes beyond advertising It goes into the world of delivering stronger value propositions, serving clients more strongly, and communicating with them better. I think let's spend a couple, 2, 3 minutes, 4 minutes on this, because this is the heart of what I wanted to talk about. You know, if you look at it, you know, from a delivering value proposition, how can we use digital to deliver stronger value propositions? So the first thing is that smarter companies, including companies like Citi, what they're trying to do is they're trying to find those digital components which can be either added to their analog delivery to make a more stronger impact, or substituting their physical delivery with digital delivery to make a stronger impact. Let me give you examples of both. If you look at you know, adding a digital component to a physical delivery, a good example is that of a company like Nike. So Nike is in the business of creating shoes and accessories to improve the performance of sports people. So what did they do? They launched devices like FuelBand. They created applications like Nike Air, which were existing outside of the shoes and accessories, but were primarily meant to fulfill the core brand promise of improving the performance of the athletes. Let's not look at Nike globally. Look at back home in our country. There's a company which everybody, you know, everyone I'm presuming here would be aware of, Just Dial. All of us use it. It's the yellow pages of India on the phone. Now, you know, some time back when Just Dial became quite successful, they realized that they can increase the power of their franchise, that if they can take their core capability from phone onto online. So it is quite symbolic of today that there is a company named Just Dial, and that company becomes big because it has justdial.com. And that shows how by adding a component of digital, a company which is supposed to be on the phone becomes much larger. Let's look at substitution. A great example of substitution of value proposition elements with digital is airline industry. It's not too long back, I think all of us would remember, that when we had to buy tickets, you had to go to a travel agent, call up the travel agent, or go to an airport, or go to a city office and buy tickets. Look at the world that we are in travel industry today, and it's just spend a moment on that. You can buy tickets online, the tickets comes to you electronically, you can web check in electronically, you can choose your seat sitting at home. If you check in via Facebook, in some airlines, you can see where your friends on the social network are sitting in the plane. So even if you didn't know that you're traveling on the same flight, you can actually book a seat right next to that person on the flight. If you go on airlines like Virgin Atlantic, you can go onto their in-flight entertainment. When you're watching movies, you will see that it's connected socially, and you can see the number of people who have traveled on the plane who liked the movie in addition to the expert scores. You have online connectivity on Virgin. When you land, you will get an SMS alert for the preferred customers that how much time is left for your baggage to come. Every component, apart from just flying from point A to point B, has got digitally enabled, and that has vastly changed the whole value proposition delivery for the customer. So that's the bucket of value proposition. Let's look at service. I think all of you will agree with me that Google is a service company at the end of the day. It's serving its customers. But how many of you know, do you guys know that Google actually is a service company but doesn't have a service department? There's no customer care number. You can't call up anybody, and if you've got a problem in Chrome, you can't call up anybody and seek service. But what Google and companies like Google have done, when you want help from Google, so there's something called help, but actually what the help is that they have nurtured these online communities where people come together. So if you want some help on Chrome, there'll be somebody who's on a community of Chrome who will help you answer that, and peer-to-peer resolution solves the problem instantly. Now that's a remarkable thing. There are good companies like Dell, Microsoft, even Citi, which have created these dynamic FAQs on their websites or virtual assistants where you can get instant resolution to their problems. Now while I'm on this topic of, you know, how digital marketing is beyond advertising, I want to call out one very interesting opportunity for all of us to note. I think the biggest opportunity out there which is coming our way is this, what I call as ability to deliver connected experiences. Now, you know, if all of us were to go back to our B schools or our school days, right, when we learned marketing, we were told that by Kotler that the holy grail of marketing is to understand the unique special needs of every customer and then giving them a product or service which is designed to serve that customer or fulfill the need of that customer. But frankly, how much is it possible in the analog world? You know, most of us have sold cars, you know, phones, soap tablets, or even credit cards, right? There is a limit to which you can customize products in the analog world. But look at what the digital world has taught us and how the world, therefore, of marketing is changing. You have products like Flipboard, which is essentially an online magazine. Now, when earlier, before Flipboard came, the way our magazines used to work is you had to go to a magazine, you know, shop, you buy a Time magazine, a great magazine like Fortune magazine. But then even there, when you were reading that magazine, the editorial content of that magazine was determined by the editor of that magazine. They used to decide what you have to read. But what Flipboard did is said, you know what, you decide what content you want to see. If you like sports, you can get more of sports. If you like news, you get more of news. If you like to read about social, you can read more about social. If you like viral videos, you can read about viral videos. You can choose the social network you want to integrate. So almost, you know, almost when you get into that magazine, it is your magazine. It is customized to you. You are the editor of that magazine. It is a truly connected experience. Now, what did the analog world learn from it? Look at the analog world. A few years back, not too long back, when you used to buy a handset, like a Nokia or any other handset, everything used to be determined. Besides the outside feature, every icon on that used to be fixed. You knew exactly what's going to be the buttons in that phone. Then came iPhone, which said, you can now decide what you want to put inside. I'm going to give you 5-6 buttons. If you want to play a different game from what I give you, you can download it from the App Store. So everything in the phone got customized. The same thing is happening in the television world. So Samsung today has launched television where when you log on to the phone and you get inside the phone, you will find that against that, get inside the television and you switch it on, it will give you a customized recommendation. It will say that if, let's say, it will tell Manish that if Manish used to watch this program, has been watching these comedy programs for the last 2 weeks, then it will throw up recommendations of a comedy program. It will give it a different recommendation on a weekday, different recommendation on a weekend. And if Manish's wife logs in, she will get a different recommendation because the television will recognize who has logged in. So, you know, that's the world that we are into, where the value proposition and the experience that's going to be delivered by marketeers is going to be customized and connected to the person. Now, what will drive this change? This change, to me, will be driven almost entirely, if not completely, by the mobile phones. And why do I say that? I say that because mobile phones, are, first of all, are connected to the internet. Secondly, they're smarter. You know, mobile phones have superior information about a customer as compared to, say, a desktop. A mobile phone knows what is the location of the place. The mobile phone knows what is the past experience of the customer, so it has a superior understanding. Third, because of it being digitally connected, mobile phones also have history. They have memory of your experience. Therefore, their ability for it to customize and give you context is superior. And fourth, and probably the most important reason, is that mobile is the most convenient platform. You are always having access to the mobile at all points of time. Which is why if you see that in the world, what is changing quite fast is that the access to internet and the entire value proposition delivery is moving on mobile. So Facebook, for example, 75% of logins happen through mobile. In India, 40% of online searches are happening through mobile. Now, the other important aspect of mobile is that the number is not small. I'll give you an interesting perspective on the sheer reach of mobile. There is a study which has come out, which was thrown out, which said that the number of people in the world who use mobile phone is more than the number of people in the world who use a toothbrush. Now that's really counterintuitive, and that's the reality of the world that we live in today. And India is not a different story. You know, we have 800 million people, but what is more important and interesting and different about India is that unlike the West, which has desktop penetration, India has low desktop penetration. So if you look at internet access, 50% of internet access in India happens through mobile phones, as compared to the West, where 25% of access happens through mobile phones. So again, you know, the mobile as an is going to be a very important piece. You know, the good companies and companies, including Citi, the way we think is that we're moving away, more and more away from just thinking about digital-first strategy to a mobile-first strategy. Almost like Mr. Mark Zuckerberg said in the last, you know, annual conference, he said, when we look at any product and we design any product, we first think, how will it look in mobile? And then we think about everything else. And that's the future, and I think we've got to be cognizant of it. The advertising part of mobile is still in its infancy. So in India, out of 3,000 crores spent on advertising, only 10% is going on mobile. And that's something which I think will change, because if you look at some of our Western counterparts like UK, etc., you know, UK about 26% of the total spends on digital go on mobile. So there is distance to travel there, and I think that's another piece which will move in the sharply in the next 5 years. Lastly, I think, why does this, what is going to come in the way, if at all? And I think there has been lots of, again, discussion around things like infrastructure. You know, there is not enough broadband infrastructure. There's not enough connectivity. You know, 3G versus 2G. You know, all that is going to fall in place. I think the thing that probably will may come in the way, if at all, is going to be, do we have the adequate human capital skills built in this country for people to actually take advantage of this change? And here I think we have some trouble. If you look at any senior marketeer surveys happening in the country, you'll find that around 75% of the senior marketeers in the country feel that they are not adequately staffed when it comes to digital talent. And I think that aspect is something to worry about. That is an aspect that, you know, is when we are living in a world where the consumer has a blended life between analog and digital, and the future is more digital, it's important for us marketers to equip ourselves. And I think this responsibility is not just with manufacturers, it's with manufacturers and with individuals. From a manufacturer's perspective, something like Citi or, you know, Unilever, what they have to think about, they have to make sure they have adequate training provisions, training mechanism, training infrastructure for their managers. They got to have a minimum standard of digital skills of people that they're hiring in the company today. They have to hire experts of digital to make sure that these experts are able to raise the bar of everybody else in the company as they stay there. But you know, the onus is not just on the manufacturer. It's on us, people like me, people like you, because it is equally on us to see what are we doing about making sure that we are actually enhancing our skills. And here are two or three things that are important. Are we avid users ourselves of these social networks, of technology? Are we making ourselves familiar with this technology? How much are we reading on a regular basis? If the world of technology is changing so fast and the opportunity is changing so fast, are we reading enough to keep pace with it? And lastly, but not the least, are we experimenting? Are we putting in some money on mobile advertising, on search to learn something? Because even if you make mistakes, there's no better way to learn than to go out there, make mistakes, and then get yourself better. I think that's what I wanted to talk about on a whole. And to summarize, there is a connected consumer out there, connected to internet, connected socially, connected to smart devices. The power that's going to unleash for marketing is the real fundamental change in the way we're going to deliver value proposition, service, and communication to clients. It's going to get enabled through mobile. And lastly, the only thing which can possibly come in the way in the long run is going to be human capital and adequate skills of digital in the country. Back to you.
Hi, Sanjeev. Good to hear you. It was a great experience you've shared with, you know, all of us. My background is also a bit of social media. There's a company called TechShot Digital, which is owned by Jay Motwani, and there are a few of the cricketers which they have signed and working for them. And I used to work for them before. What I have learned from there, that they are like, you know, coming up with new ideas for, you know, Facebook and promoting them and getting, you know, money out of that. So somewhere or the other, still it's, you know, lacking somewhere. You know, we are not, you know, they're not, you know, making much money that how to use exactly, you know, how to use and promote them on Facebook and make money out of that. On G Plus, like G Plus Hangout is recently, you know, launched. They are, you know, doing lots of Hangouts. A few days back with the cricketers called VVS Lakshman, they did a great Hangout with the Association of Red FM. But, you know, it's not going on that way. But how can we, you know, make it on a bigger way if we want to do it on a larger way?
Okay, so I think what you're raising is a more a fundamental point, and it's often come out that there is a world out there which says that, you know, how much of social works and how much of social doesn't work, and do we really invest in social, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So let me, because I don't have as much of information about, you know, your company and context, and maybe we can take that offline, I'll try and answer some parts of it, but I'll try and answer at a holistic level also. I think, you know, the first thing that we have to understand and be humble about is the fact that our consumers are spending 25% of their time on social. That means, as I said before, 1 out of 4 minutes is being spent on social. Now, it is the onus and the responsibility is on people like us to make that work. So many people say social doesn't work, but, you know, 5 decades back when television was introduced, and that time there used to be only print medium, the marketeer struggled in the first 4 or 5 years to make television work. The general belief was that television doesn't work, print continues to work. So I think this is a struggle of every new platform, and it is up to us to say, if consumers are spending time there, how do I make it work? Now let's look at how do we make it work, and I think there are two or three things there. You know, when the social network started, you know, there was this mad rush for likes, mad rush for, you know, getting more fans, getting more likes, etc., etc. But then the reality, you know, came up that are you just going for likes or are you going for conversation? Are you really leveraging the power of the platform to create a conversation with your consumers and creating an interaction? But, you know, I think the time has come now that as people have moved on from creating likes to conversations, they need to move now from conversations to commerce. So there has to be a business integration there, right? And now there are two or three things that can happen on business integration, which is happening now across. The first thing on business integration which is happening is that what social networks give you is a very powerful capability of selecting the audience that you will talk to. Now, you know, if I want to do today advertise on Times of India, you know, I it's a great newspaper, great reach, and this is not about Times of India or Hindustan Times, but any leading newspaper, I put an ad, it goes to everybody. I do not have the power to segregate and dissect the population. Whether you are a sports person marketing yourself or you are a, you know, a baby products manufacturer or a credit card, I have today an ability to go to LinkedIn, Facebook or any of these platforms and say, can you make a custom audience for me? And they all give you this tool. You can custom audience, you can dissect the base of the people that you want to talk to. If you're spending money or you're trying to focus your resources, you are spending it where there's maximum bang for the buck. So that's one example of business integration. The second example of business integration is that depending on what business you are in, are you integrating commerce in your social pages? So there are lots of great examples, and the fashion industry took the lead in this, particularly the luxury industry in the West, where they said, if my consumer is discussing fashion on social, they are spending time on social to discuss fashion, like the way sports are getting discussed. Can I open up a store on social? So brands like Burberry or many of these brands said, I'll open up a store, a virtual store, where you can buy stuff on Facebook itself. So a similar example is that if I'm Vivek Lakshman, and let's say, you know, I have many memorabilia from cricket that I can actually use to engage with my people, but also if I want to raise money by actually selling some of that merchandise. Can I create a virtual store on Facebook which allows people to transact and do e-commerce, which is called F-commerce, or it could be, depending on the network you're talking about, it's T-commerce, F-commerce, etc., and do business integration. I think that's the second thing. The third thing that I will tell you on social is that, you know, when the social is a very powerful tool to listen as marketers to what's happening out there, you're able to capture the word of mouth. And whether you are a cricketer or you are a credit card manufacturer, it's very important to understand what are people talking about you. Do you pick up just a cricketer like a Vivek Lakshman or Rahul Dravid? Do they actually hear what is it that people are expecting from them? And if you don't pick up these insights, you will not know how to refine or change your product. And I think that facility was not available in the analog world, but that's what social gives you. So you got to have the listening posts out there and make sure that you're getting insights on a regular basis to go and change the products that you're giving and experience you're giving to your consumer.
I was saying, like Mr. Sanju spoke about how technology was transcending geographies. My question is, it's also transcending industries, I guess. An example would be how OLX and Quikers of the world have become direct competition to someone like a Maruti or someone who's in the aftermarket sector. For example, I'm in Mahindra First Choice Services. So we're in the aftermarket sector. It affects OLX and Quikr affects the second-hand car sales also. So there's another problem that which Mr. Sanjeev would identify with. For example, an Airtel coming up with an application, say, like Airtel Money, which is in direct competition with a bank, providing a banking service.
I think that's a very good question, and there's no easy answer for this. But what I would say is that, you know, this was always the case. So whether you worked on any industry, there was always a threat of competition coming up with innovation. I think what has changed is that what some of the newer companies, the younger companies are trying to do is that they are interpreting the same consumer and giving solutions which are non-linear, which were not thought about before. Now, there are only two ways to deal with it, right? So either the large companies like Citi, Maruti, etc. need to always stay humble, and they need to make sure that they are thinking constantly, even though they may be leaders in their respective spaces, how can I go and reinterpret this product? And if a leader does that to himself, where he is constantly challenging conventional wisdom, challenging the old products, every 1 or 2 years saying, if I had to do this product completely in a different way, how would I do it? Then only it will buy. And it's true for not only just Citi, even Apple. If Apple misses a trick for a 2 years period, as you see companies like BlackBerry, you know, even in large established companies, you miss a trick, you miss a technology. You know, companies like Nokia and BlackBerry, we have seen in our own last decade, they come to, you know, almost to their knees. So that's true for all companies. So the first thing you want to do is to constantly challenge your existing product. And the second thing is that you have to do is that I think as large companies, you have to create a situation internally where you're already ready and you're nimble enough to change. So I think what many companies have realized is that their backends have to become much more flexible than they used to be in the past, right? When the manufacturing started by Ford, it started with this whole premise of Henry Ford saying you can buy as any car from me as long as it's Ford Black Model T, if you remember, right? You can only buy a black car, you can only buy a Model T, but you can buy any car. Now, from there to today, we have to move into a situation where your backend is so flexible that it is nimble enough to make changes as and when the environment is changing. So that's the second thing that large companies have to do. The third thing, I think, and not the least, sometimes it's important to go with the flow, right? So if, let's say, you are in the Maruti and you're in the business of selling cars, you want to take a step back and say, if somebody is creating an environment for you, a right platform for you to sell your second-hand Maruti cars, which will increase, therefore, the value proposition of those cars and utility for customers, it's not a bad thing. Then the next question you do is that if I don't want to do that, that's not my core business, how can I actually partner with Quikr and make sure that that process becomes even better for my end consumers? Because if I can do that and I start thinking in a collaborative fashion, then I end up giving a more powerful experience to my customer. So, you know, a good example of that is look at Apple and Google, right? Google and Apple are as big competitors as it can be. But a Google map sits on the Apple phone. Now, why would, you know, Apple can also come back and say, I won't keep my competitor's app. But the fact is, Apple phone loses out if it doesn't keep the Google map on his phone. So, you know, the new world is a very interesting world, which is called the phrase, the jargon used for this is called frenemy. You are a friend and an enemy. So if Quikr becomes your enemy, become friends with it and make it a frenemy so that you can collaborate with them and actually make a more powerful delivery. So you've got to do these three things in combination. Challenge yourself, create a flexible backend, and third, make your enemies your friends and collaborate and win your customers. Focus on customers and not on your competitors.
Hi, Sanjeev, it was a great experience for me to learn about digital marketing from you. So my question is more along the lines of comparing the traditional marketing with the online marketing which we are currently seeing up. So if we see the traditional marketing like mass advertising, print, and the other mediums, we used to measure these marketing on the basis of how the consumer perception is changing by them in terms of the brand recall and other related ads. But when we talk about online marketing, whether it's through Facebook or it's whether it's email or SEM, we do talk about a lot of convergence, and in different industries, we also talk about the sales it generates. For example, in case of an e-commerce, we also measure how much sales these media are generating for us. So what is your perspective that is online marketing more about converting customers and more related to sales as compared to the traditional offline marketing that we earlier had?
Well, sadly, the answer is no. I think the core purpose of marketing doesn't change and it will never change, which is to understand customers well and then creating products, advertising, and other services which creates a preference for your brand, either for them to buy your brand or to use your brand more often if you're in a service industry. I don't think that core job of marketing is going to change ever. What you're really seeing is a change in platform of consumption of information, of commerce, and of advertising, right? It just so happens that digital advertising gives you an added advantage, which is a very important advantage, that it gives you much better texture in terms of for every dollar that you invested, what really happened. Now, that's tougher in television. It's a little easier in print, but very, very tough also in radio. So I think that strength should not be seen as the limitation or that's the only objective of that platform. But just that this platform also has the same job to create a preference for the brand in the minds of people to buy it more often, but you can measure it more effectively. And to answer your other part, which is of brand track, I think the brand track will still remain. Now, what you can do is two things. When you're running a brand track, at the end of the day, when a brand track respondent like me is walking on the street and you come and ask me a question, my response to you is not going to be based on the television advertising I saw. It's going to be based on everything that you've done, the television advertising you've done, the online advertising I've done, and therefore it's going to give you a composite answer. That thing should not change. However, what you should have is two things. What you can do is you can create a component within your brand track which measures what has been the specific impact of online on trading the brand scores. That's first piece. The second thing that you can do is you can migrate some part of that brand track online and run online tracks. That will give you a better texture of specifically about the actions that you've taken on digital marketing and digital advertising and how does that translate into driving preference or loyalty for your brand.
Hi Sanjeev, my question is, BFSI industry has to operate a lot under government regulations. Now, at one point you did mention about experimenting on digital, and a lot of the other brands like consumer durables and consumer electronics have that liberty because they don't have to follow that kind of regulations which a BFSI brand has to follow. What in your experience and vision, how does it come in your way, because digital is growing very fast, so does it become a roadblock for you as a, for your brand to experiment, or are there ways around it?
Okay, that's a good question. I think I'll answer that in two ways. First of all, I've worked across now some industries, so I will say that every industry has some form or nature of regulation. So telecom has regulation, media has regulation, even banking has regulation. You know, some has more, some has less, but dealing with regulation is part of doing business in any particular industry which is there. So I don't think that's a difference. Yes, there are a few things which, because it's regulated more strongly, there are a few things that you can't do which you could do more easily in some of the other industries. But let me tell you that banking industry, on the other hand, as compared to many industry, has one very powerful advantage that no other industry has, which is the transaction platform. Today, you know, if you are dealing with a Luxo, what will you do online beyond a point? Apart from just hearing about, you know, if I've worked on both Lux and I've worked on Citi and Hindustan Lever, right? If I'm a Lux brand manager, there's a limit to which you can deal with Lux online. At best, you can buy a soap from, say, a Flipkart if they were to sell soaps. But look at banking. Today, 60% of my transactions are happening online. People are coming to transfer money, to recharge their phone, to make payments, to their billers, whether it's telecom, to pay rents, to pay their school admission fees, to make investments, to buy insurance, to make credit card purchase, sales. So imagine that, you know, if you have millions of customers, 60% of them are coming back to you every month to do business with you. So you have a very natural flow of people coming online to you. And all that you have to do as marketer is to take advantage of that natural flow that that industry offers. And that is only possible in a service industry, that ability and capability. If you're a car manufacturer or a soap manufacturer, you don't have that advantage. You may have some advantage from a advertising perspective, but not from a transaction perspective. So I think banking is, if you ask me, on the contrary, extremely well placed. And I have an advantage in I would say, as a marketer over some of my peers who have struggled to get their people back onto their platform.
Sanjeev, I have a question for you, and my question to you is that in a largely digital world where there isn't any interface with the customer, and especially in places like banks, because you know where there could be a fair amount of business transacted, and a large amount of business could be generated with some eye-to-eye contact. Is that a problem that you all face with too much of emphasis on the digital interface?
Again, it's a fabulous question. I think, you know, when it comes to banking or any other industry similar to banking, there are two kinds of dealings that you do with customers. One is either providing information or allowing helping people transact faster, better. But there are times when customers need advice. They need some expertise. They need some hand-holding. And in those cases, especially in things like when you are making an investments on mutual funds or you're buying insurances, you need to have consultations with your banking relationship manager or somebody in the bank to get their wisdom. In, you know, not every one of those interactions can be substituted with just a remote transaction. And which is why there is always going to be a role for the branches to play, where people can walk into a branch, talk to a branch manager or talk to some people and get some advice there. But what will digital do is that, just like today, we could have been sitting in the same office face to face and having a discussion about marketing and have some consultation and you know, questions about marketing, or you could have come into the office or a third party location. I think banking will also move through that transition where even if a customer is looking for advice, you don't necessarily need the customer to come to a premise like a branch for that to happen, or an RM or a bank official to visit somebody's house. Today, you know, and I'm not saying that just to make a point, if there is a secure environment built by the bank where you can do a FaceTime with the customer which can substitute to an in-person discussion, why not? If that saves time for both customer and the bank and makes things efficient and faster, the world will move towards that direction. So I think, you know, the apps of bank phones will have video capabilities, will have voice capabilities. You can directly deal with some person pronto through your mobile phones or video phones. And I think that's going to, the way it's going to change. But I don't think some of the conversations which require advice will move to a remote or a robotic kind of conversation.
I request you to you know, on the basis of what questions that have been asked, any final comments from your side?
I know technology has a bit of challenge, but nothing like having a live interaction and remote interaction. I think I've already summarized that, you know, all of us need to be cognizant as marketers that we're entering into a world where, you know, it's not a question now anymore that whether digital is going to be big. I think it's a foregone conclusion. Digital is going to play a much larger role. The onus is back on us. I mean, you know, the world, the future of marketing is going to be data-driven and digital marketing. And I think if I were to borrow from Darwin's theory, only the fittest will survive. So I guess all of us need to get fit, be ready for the future, make sure that we are, you know, skilled enough to take the future and play to win.
Thanks a lot, Sanjeev. And thanks a lot to all our panelists.